In an emergency situation, a brief eyeball method in assessment of LV contractility is recommended. This relatively subjective evaluation can also be supplemented by the measurement of fractional shortening and so-called E-point septal separation, or EPSS. By the end of this step, an emergency veterinarian should be able to tell if the patient in front of him or her has a hyperdynamic, normal, depressed, or severely depressed left ventricular function. The examination of LV focuses on evaluating motion of the left ventricular walls by a visual estimation of the volume change from diastole to systole. Three main components of LV function assessment include the following. First, estimating the endocardial excursion, in other words, movement of each portion of the endocardium towards the center of the heart. Second, myocardial thickening based on the fact that the LV wall with normal function will get thicker during systole. You can think about an empty urinary bladder, which walls always appear thicker as compared with a distended bladder. The third component is the septal motion of anterior leaflet of mitral valve. Normally, anterior leaflet should come closer to the interventricular septum because lots of blood is moving through the mitral valve during diastole. If the leaflet approximates the septum, the function is good. If the distance between the leaflet and the septum is large, the LV function is likely decreased. It is important to attempt the evaluation of the LV function in two different views to avoid mistakes in interpretation. This sound loop was recorded by our ICU point of care ultrasound machine. This is a standard right parasternal long axis view obtained from a standing dog. If you look at this heart, LV has a pretty good endocardial excursion. The interventricular septum and the free LV wall gets thicker during contraction, and finally, the anterior mitral leaflet is almost touching the interventricular septum at the end of diastole. Based on this eyeball assessment, we can conclude that this dog's LV function is normal. This is a right parasternal short axis view obtained from the same dog as in the previous slide. Here you can appreciate two papillary muscles and so-called mushroom view. The quality of the image and image acquisition is relatively good given that it was obtained by the non-cardiology ultrasound machine in a standing dog. Similar to the long axis view, you can appreciate a good endocardial excursion and thickening of the interventricular septum as well as the free LV wall during the systole, which is consistent with normal LV function. When assessing LV function, it is very important to avoid oblique views due to the so-called cylinder tangent effect that occurs if the plane of the beam enters the chamber or vessel at a tangent, which falsely reduces its diameter. For example, this image is a transverse view of the canine thorax obtained by a CT scan with contrast. If you put the ultrasound beam at the level of the papillary muscles, you will get a standard right parasternal short axis view. If you redirect your beam towards the left ventricular apex, the ventricular walls will appear thicker and the LV lumen will appear smaller. By obtaining an oblique view in a dog with impaired LV function, it may be misinterpreted as normal or even hyperdynamic. Therefore, it is important to visualize the papillary muscles and to acquire classic mushroom view when interpreting LV function in the right parasternal short axis view. The same cylinder tangent effect may occur when you image major vessels, such as a caudal vena cava. If the ultrasound beam fails to be directed through the center of the vessel and instead the beam is tangent to it, the diameter of the vessel may be underestimated. One way to avoid this problem is to obtain both short and long axis views of the vessel and compare the results between the two. This is an example of a hyperdynamic left ventricle. Here, you can appreciate a small LV lumen during systole and vigorous hyperkinetic contractions obliterating the ventricle in systole. Also, you can appreciate so-called kissing of the papillary muscles that come in contact during LV contraction. Hyperdynamic LV is traditionally associated with a hypovolemic shock. However, its presence doesn't always equal to volume depletion in your patient. Besides hypovolemic shock, it may occur in patients with distributive shock or global vasodilatory state. Arterial vasodilation causes decreased afterload for the left ventricle, making its job much easier. In addition, commonly increased sympathetic tone during the state of distributive shock further increases LV contractility. As a result of reduced afterload and endogenous catecholamines effects, LV may appear hyperdynamic in the absence of hypovolemia. This slide compares normal and hyperdynamic hearts back-to-back for better appreciation of the differences between the two contractile states. To the left, you can see the left ventricle with normal contractility, and to the right, hyperdynamic left ventricle. Finally, this is an example of the hypodynamic heart. The video clip in the center represents a right parasternal long axis view. If you look at this heart, there's minimal endocardial excursion towards the center of the LV. The interventricular septum and free LV wall don't get thicker during contraction. Finally, the anterior mitral leaflet is barely moving, therefore there's a huge distance between the leaflet and the interventricular septum at the end of diastole. Based on this eyeball assessment, we can confidently conclude that this dog's LV function is hypodynamic. On the right parasternal short axis view, you can appreciate very similar findings, poor endocardial excursion, and a lack of wall thickening during systole.